Father, we want to pause right now. We want to ask that as we continue our time of worship, our time of study, that you would speak to us, that you would be our teacher and our guide. Lord, there's nothing here that we can do in and of ourselves, Lord, to be able to understand fully, to apply and to live and to follow you with all our hearts. Everything, even strength to obey and willingness to follow, is a gift from you. Yes, we make a choice, but you give us that strength and that desire and that passion, Lord. And perhaps some of us are struggling this morning to follow you faithfully in some area of our life. We confess with our lips, but Lord, in our practice, it can be often difficult. So Lord, please, as we talk about confession today, we pray that you would guide us, that you'd bless us, that you'd help us to understand more deeply and live more fully for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So my quick introduction, so to speak, my quick reflection, which is not quick in the sense that I'm just going to mention mothers at the beginning and then move on and forget about mothers. But I do want to start with a blessing and with a special way to honor our mothers and to honor each woman this morning. Whether we have children or no children, this is a time where we can honor the women in our lives. And some of us have biological children. Some of us have children by choice, right? People that we've either adopted into our family who are like children, who perhaps consider themselves part of our family. And so in many ways, there are people in our lives who are family or are like family. And each mother and each woman here this morning is a gift from God in our lives, in our church, and in our world. And I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to each woman here, each mother here, for the way that you are a blessing, again, in our church, in our lives, in this world. Thank you. And may the grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and bless you. That's my prayer and desire for each of you today. And it's hard. Being a mother, being a parent is a difficult thing. But God promises to be with us and to strengthen us, no matter where we're at in our parenting journey, so to speak. Many of us here have children who are grown up and are out of the home, but that doesn't make us any less parents and desirous of the good and the work of God in the lives of those we love so dearly. So today, we're going to continue this series on the book Steps to Christ. And we've titled our series Steps with Christ, because Christ is with us each step of the way. Now, chapter 4 of this book is titled Confession. Chapter 3 was repentance. Chapter 4 is confession. And really, repentance and confession go hand in hand. And if we were to discuss the sequence, we might be tempted to say, well, confession comes first. But it's actually second in the sequence of the book. Not to say that there's a rigid order as to how the book was laid out. But now we're dealing with confession. And I want to start with defining the word confession, because I think we're going to find something fascinating, and we're going to see how it connects to our reflection this morning on mothers. So the definition of the word confession, especially as we look at it in the context of chapter 4 of the book Steps to Christ, we'd simply say that confession has to do with confessing one's sins, right? And that is a super critical part of growing in Christ, is to confess one's sins. Now, in that definition and in that concept and understanding of the word confession, I want to use a word that I think is absolutely critical to help us go a little bit deeper in our understanding of the word confession, and that is the word acknowledge or acknowledgement. All right? And it's really kind of built on two words, a knowledge, you know, a knowledge, right? To know, to see, to understand. So when we're talking about confessing our sins, really, we just have to really pause for a moment and say, are we acknowledging that we have sinned, that we have failed and fallen? So a true confession is a true acknowledgement. It's not just saying the words, which is a type of acknowledgement, but it's really coming face to face and saying, God, search me. Help me to see and to acknowledge, to understand where I'm at and where I have fallen. But when we talk about confession, in a sense, we think about it in the negative sense because we're talking about sin, we're talking about failures, we're talking about faults. So we think about it in the negative sense, so we acknowledge how we have sinned and failed. But there's a positive sense to the word confession, and that is when you confess faith, right? When you confess belief in something or someone in our God. And as we talk about love, and as we talk a little bit about mothers today, when we confess love to others, or to a spouse, or to a mother, that is a very positive use of the word confession. And I'll kind of steal my own thunder. We'll come full circle to this at the end. I think this is where we fail in a lot of ways, is missing those opportunities to confess love and to build one another up and just to say, I love you. I appreciate you. We'll come back to that full circle as we come to the end of our study this morning. So with this definition in mind, the two aspects, the two sides of the coin, the positive, so to speak, and the negative of what it means to confess, we can ask this question: what is the benefit of confession or confessing? So as we begin answering this question, we want to look to John chapter 4. We want to turn to the story of the woman at the well. And we're going to find it fascinating because perhaps we haven't looked at it from this angle, that we see both elements of confession represented in this story in John chapter 4. But before we go to the main teaching, the main point, so to speak, of this passage, there is some critical background theology that I don't want us to miss as it relates to this story of Jesus' meeting with the woman at the well. The background theology I want to emphasize first is that this inspired account, it illustrates how valued women are in the eyes of God. How valued mothers are, even divorcees are in the eyes of God. I mean, sometimes we don't properly emphasize and understand the significance, but this woman really represented all of that. We don't know if she had children, but it's likely that she did. If she'd had five husbands, certainly there would have been some kids. So here we see a woman, we see a mother, we see a divorcee, that Jesus goes out of his way to meet. The disciples certainly would have wanted to go around Samaria, but Jesus goes with his disciples through Samaria on his destination to where he was going. Why would have they wanted to go around Samaria? Well, this was the Samaritan town. This was a people that they were in conflict with. And before we get into all of that, again, this story shows us how valuable women, mothers, divorcees are in the eyes of God. The Bible highly honors women and always seeks to restore women to the high place they were designed to fill as equal co-rulers in the garden and in our world. The text indicates all of this, and this is a critical background to the full story of Jesus' divine appointment with a woman in broad daylight. Think about it. Nicodemus in chapter 3 came in the dark of night, but Jesus was willing to meet with a Samaritan with a woman in broad daylight. That should speak volumes to the significance of this story. And I believe Jesus was seeking to break cultural norms that were oppressive to women. Jesus came to set the captives free, and that includes women. Amen? So what about today? What about us? How are women still oppressed? What can we do as we think about women this weekend and mothers? What can we do to honor mothers, to honor women? I believe this is just as much a part of the gospel message, just as much a part of our mission as it is to proclaim, worship God, and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come. The gospel is delivering the oppressed and setting the captives free in all ages, all races, all genders. Amen? Jesus, a Jew, asks for water from a Samaritan woman. The story illustrates prejudice. It illustrates segregation. And this interaction, this divine appointment, leads to a conversation about spiritual, not physical water. And so now we want to pick up the story in verse 13. The Bible says, just following along as we read, John chapter 4, beginning in verse 13, Jesus replied, "Everyone who drinks some of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks some of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again." She doesn't realize it yet, but Jesus is talking about spiritual water, not physical water. In the middle of verse 14, it says, "But the water that I give him," or her in this case, "will become in them a fountain of water springing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Clearly, the woman is thinking Jesus is talking about physical water. But Jesus is not offering a drink. He's offering life. He's offering love. And this is the key to setting this woman free. If she will but accept not physical but spiritual water, if she will accept the life and the love that he is offering. But this woman is not ready to acknowledge or to confess her sin. But by the end of this conversation, Jesus declares himself the Messiah and gives this woman an opportunity to confess and to acknowledge her sin and to accept him, confess him as the Messiah. So we jump forward in the story to verse 25. It says, "The woman said to him, 'I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. Whenever he comes, he will tell us everything.' Jesus said to her, 'I, the one speaking to you, am he.'" Jesus just comes out, fully reveals himself and says, I am the Messiah. I am the Christ. You're looking to the future thinking that the Messiah is coming. He's here. He's standing right in front of you. And the whole story is not told as to the conversation or as to what was happening in her mind. But we see a shift, and the results are clear. This woman has been set free to love. And now she cannot contain her joy. Let's continue reading verse 27 through to verse 30. Now at the very moment his disciples came back, his disciples came back, they were shocked because he was speaking with a woman. However, no one said, what do you want, or why are you speaking with her? Then the woman left her water jar, went off into the town, and said to the people, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Now my version is going to read a little bit differently than yours, but I'm going to explain it in a moment. So again, beginning in verse 29, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Surely he can't be the Messiah, can he? So my version translates it with this question, this inquiry, raising the question to the people that she's preaching to, essentially, could this be the Messiah? The reason of the difference in translation is that the Greek is actually kind of challenging, and it can be translated in different ways. But the point is that there's this stirring question that comes up in the story because she has just recently realized that this might be the Messiah. But implied is that she realizes he's special because he told her everything she ever did. And rather than a question of doubt, rather than questioning whether she really identified and believed that he was the Messiah, this translation is going in the direction of raising the question that she would have come back to the people in her village saying, think about it. Think about it. Could this be the Christ? She, we no doubt believe, realized that Jesus was the Christ. And now coming back to that definition of confession, she was acknowledging and she was confessing her belief and her love in Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ. But while we don't see it directly indicated, she must have also confessed her sin. Because she could say to the people in her village, who would have known, right? This woman wouldn't have been a unknown person in her town. She was known enough that no one wanted to associate with her, right? She had to come all by herself to the water, to the well in the heat of the day. We know at least 5 or 6 individuals knew her in many ways because she had had 5 husbands, and the one that she was with was not her husband. And so for her to go into this town and to say that he told me everything I ever did, she was by nature confessing her faults, acknowledging her sin and her weakness and her brokenness. She was no longer hiding her shame, her sin, her secrets. She had been set free. And she was declaring, come see a man who knows my mess, yet offers love, offers mercy. Let's go to Proverbs 28 and verse 13. As we come back to this theme of confession, Proverbs 28 stresses the seriousness and the significance of us taking confession seriously. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13. The Bible says, "The one who covers his transgressions will not prosper. But whoever confesses them and forsakes them will find mercy." This verse couldn't be no clearer, no more powerful than the importance of us not just acknowledging, but with true acknowledgement, it leads to repentance, it leads to forsaking, it leads to turning from our sin. And you may remember that in our previous presentation on repentance, we said we defined repentance as learning to love again. True confession, true repentance leads to forsaking whatever it is that has come between us and God. Forsaking those things so that we can learn to love again and we can come back into deeper union with Christ. So we've been called to confess. We've been called to forsake. The question is, do you want freedom? Do you want healing like this woman that Jesus met at the well? Do you want freedom to love? As we confess, as we acknowledge, that barrier is now removed, because we have to think about it. When we withhold confession, there is a barrier between us and Christ, between us and the person we have hurt, and we are not free to love. But once we acknowledge, once we confess, we are free to love. Love and the ability to love freely, it starts with confession. Let's go to James chapter 5. And we're going to see the important connection between confession and healing. James is a well-known section in the New Testament that talks about the anointing service. We're just going to look really quickly at verses 13 to 16. James, chapter 5. If I said John, I meant James. James chapter 5, beginning in verse 13. It says, "Is anyone among you suffering? He should pray. Is anyone in good spirits? He should sing praises. Is anyone among you ill? He should summon the elders of the church, and they should pray for him and anoint him with olive oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed any sins, he will be forgiven." Now there's an important transition here between the end of verse 15 and 16. Because at the end of 15, we're told if he has committed his sins, he will be forgiven. So, or we could say, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great effectiveness. Confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. If we want to be set free, if we want to be healed, we have to acknowledge our sin. We have to confess our sin. It's hard sometimes to acknowledge. We want to justify. By nature, we justify our actions, our behaviors, our choices, our sins. But if we just come in humility to Christ and we acknowledge, we confess, we forsake, God is going to do a special work of healing, of transforming, of setting us free so we can be free to love. And this confession, it impacts not just our relationship with God, but our human relationships as well. So, what about our mothers, our wives, our daughters, the women in our lives? What confessions do we need to make? Where have we hurt? How have we hurt the important women in our lives? Because if we want to be free to love and have healthy relationships, it requires confession. And to go a step further and to come full circle back to the two sides of the coin as it relates to the negative confession where we confess our sins, but the confessions of love, the positive confessions and affirmation of the important people in our lives, are we making that a priority? Are we saying it enough? We take a lot of times the important people in our lives for granted. And it can even come to a point, believe it or not, but I think some of you might be able to resonate with this and identify with this. But sometimes, when we haven't made a custom of saying I love you or doing special things, it actually becomes a bit awkward, a bit difficult to do that. It's important for us to confess our love. We say, well, I show it through all the ways and through all the actions, and as husbands or as men, we provide and we do different things, right? And we do all the different jobs that are maybe either difficult or our wives or spouses don't want to do, right? But we have to say the words. We have to come up with meaningful ways to say, I love you. I believe in you. You're special. To show that affirmation. And we see some of that, of course, in the spiritual sense, but we see that in the story of the woman at the well. Not only did she confess her sin, but she confessed her belief and her love for the Savior, for the Messiah. And so perhaps this Mother's Day, we'll each have an opportunity to confess between us and God, but any ways that we may have injured the important women in our lives, and to show them the love that they deserve. Not because they've earned it, but because they're special and they're loved and cherished in the eyes of God. Our closing hymn is going to be number 493, Fill My Cup. It's not really suited, so to speak, for Mother's Day, but it's suited for the conversation about confession and the woman at the well. And so no matter where we are at, God wants to fill our cup and give us freedom to love. Please stand as we sing number 493.
I receive for things that you know. opportunity to be here, and we want to ask that you would fill our cup, Lord, and that you do for us abundantly more than we could ask or imagine. And Lord, as we go and continue through this Mother's Day weekend, we just pray that you bless our mothers, bless the women in our lives, strengthen our relationships for your glory and your honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.